Good afternoon. Thank you for attending this afternoon plenary lecture of the second day of the EMI 2013 conference. The only message I have before we start is please continue to vote for the poster sessions. We have these nice, interesting posters in the Lewis room, and at 5 p.m. we have to decide who wins, and then they will be recognized at the banquet tonight, so please keep voting. You should have received in your registration packet this voting ticket where you have a poster session for the day one and poster for the day one and poster for the day two. You just need to write the poster ID that you find in your program and of course in the posters in the Lewis room. So please do that. And with that, I think I can introduce Professor Shah from Northwestern University, who will be chairing this plenary lecture. Please.
Good afternoon, everybody. My pleasure to chair this plenary session in the afternoon. And it's a strange experience for me being on the stage of this big Steiger auditorium. Normally, I come for the concert and sit in one of the seats. So it's I didn't realize, but as long as I don't have to play any instrument, I'm fine. So it's a pleasure, really, to introduce the professional colleague and good friend, Kim Kurtis. She's a professor in School of Civil and Environmental Engineering at Georgia Tech. And before that, I knew her when she was doing her PhD at Berkeley and some very interesting work with Paolo Montero in soft X-ray. But since joining Georgia Tech, she has been very active. Her main interests are in material science of civil engineering materials with an emphasis on cement-based materials. And that she has not only published extensively, but also has patents. And among the award that Kim has received include the award that ACI gives out to young faculty members who are excellent in teaching. She also has an American Concrete Institute Jeans Instrument Award for Non-Destructive Evaluation. And recently, she got the ASC Huber Prize. So, and she's going to talk about the intersection between material science and sustainability. Professor Kurtis.
Well, thank you for that very kind introduction, and also for the kind invitation to be here, Professor Shah, Professor Kusadas, and the organizers of EMI. I have to admit, this is my first time at the EMI conference, but I've had a very warm welcome, and I've seen a lot of friendly faces around yesterday and today and in this auditorium. I do feel a little bit like a fish out of water. I'm going to be talking about materials today at a mechanics conference, and so with that in mind, what I'll be showing is sort of an umbrella type presentation, try and limit the number of chemical equations, but you'll have to bear with me. So in general, as an overview, concrete is a ubiquitous material. And I'm just showing here a couple of pictures to show the wide variety of the structures that concrete can be found in. There's really no other material that you could use to slip form a pavement with, construct a tall building, and make an arch bridge. So it's a very unique material. For that reason, I think it's sort of interesting to look at really how much concrete is used every year. I've included some numbers here. It amounts to something about 2 cubic yards per person. Okay, so if you think about a cubic yard as maybe being the size of a dishwasher, think about yourself as 2 dishwashers walking around. Everyone in this room is 2 dishwashers. Every person you've encountered today is 2 dishwashers every year full of concrete. It's an absolutely enormous quantity of material that we're talking about. And I think a lot of us in this room are probably familiar with these Ashby plots. If you look here, this is a log scale with the amount of materials used every year. And here, just to give you some context, we've got oil and coal together. And then here is concrete, a bit higher on a log scale. So it's an absolutely enormous volume of material that we're talking about being placed every year. Concrete is also a very complex material. It's got multi-scale heterogeneity, which makes it very challenging to characterize by destructive and non-destructive methods, and also through modeling. It's also opaque in its plastic state, and then it transitions into an opaque solid. And one of my specialties is in characterization of materials, and that makes it enormously challenging to assess as well. And then we also see that it changes with time. Its mechanical properties and its structure evolve with time. And I will apologize, I'm going to have to look at the screen. I put in some animation, and I don't have eyes in the back of my head, but please don't tell my children. Okay. So, concrete is an evolving material as well, and my argument today, or my thesis for this presentation, will really be that we have innovations that are happening in cement-based materials all the time. Those innovations change the way in which we construct and practice concrete technology. And as a result of these innovations, we also need to adapt and be inventive in the ways that we characterize the material. So just pulling from the abstract that I wrote for this presentation, I think way back in December, the potential for interdisciplinary collaborations on materials characterization to bring new insights to both the fundamental understanding and the practical use of cement-based materials in the context to making contributions to sustainability will really be the focus of this talk. And when I talk about materials characterization, just because it's, I think, more visual and easy to present, I'll be focusing primarily on imaging and mechanical testing, although we've certainly also done quite a bit of work on analytical methods, NDE, and modeling, not just in my group, but in the entire cement-based materials community. All right, so an overview of the talk will be, first I'll make the case that concrete is an evolving material. Then I'll talk about innovations in cements and concrete technology. Then I'll talk about some new opportunities for characterization and evaluation. And then, as promised in the abstract, I'll bring it into implementation and the challenges that are existing there in terms of making concrete an even more sustainable material. So let's first deal with this first topic, which is, what does this mean, concrete's an evolving material? And I don't just mean that it develops properties over time. What I'm really thinking about is how research and the application of concrete technology and practice have changed over time. And here I'll focus on maybe the last four decades. I will admit that I was very close to a second major in undergrad in art history. So I do tend to like to look at things in terms of eras. So you'll have to bear with me today. I will not ask you, though, at the end to identify what these structures are, though, so you can relax. But the first era I want to talk about has something to do with these two tall buildings that are familiar on the Chicago skyline. One is Water Tower Place, which was constructed in 1975. It was one of the first high-strength concrete constructions, and it took advantage of the high strength of concrete in order to make the structure more constructible, meaning that they were able to use the same forms throughout the height of the structure, which saved time and money, which potentially could contribute to sustainability. More recently, we've seen an even higher strength concrete structure. This is, I believe, still the tallest reinforced concrete structure in the U.S., and it was constructed in 1998 using 12,000 PSI concrete, and that's 311 Wacker Drive. And I'll call this era, starting in the 1970s, the era of strength. Okay. And so with the era of strength, what we saw was that there were some innovations that happened in materials and materials science, and also, as we'll see, in characterization of materials that allowed us to really jump into this era. Okay, so bear with me, if you will. One of those innovations was innovations in water-reducing admixture chemistry. And so here I'm showing acrylic polymer superplasticizing admixture that has a very long side group, and this provides the steric hindrance that provides some stability, which allows us to use very fine particles like silica fume and getting good dispersion with those. So we were able to start using more SCMs, different SCMs, reducing our water cement ratio while still maintaining workability and pumpability. And this is really what brought us into this era of high strength concrete. With increasing strengths meant new challenges in terms of characterization of the materials. We think of measurements of concrete strength as just being ubiquitous. It's one common tool for assessing the quality of concrete. But this was something that also needed to evolve in order to adapt to this era of high strength. And so in the in the 80s in particular, we started seeing questions about how to prepare the ends of cylinders. Should we still use molten sulfur? If so, how long do we cure it for? Do we use pad caps? Is end grinding the way to go? So believe it or not, something as common as compressive strength testing was something that needed to be reexamined as we entered into this era of high strength. We started then also to move beyond compression testing, looked at other innovations in testing. Here I'm showing that there was some interest in direct tension tests, really trying to quantify the tensile strength of concrete, trying to understand if that scaled with the increases in compressive strength. And then some work that we did more recently was looking at very high-strength concretes and looking at their capacity for tensile creep. So this is concrete being tested in compression, but I'm sorry, in tension rather than compression, and over time, and looking at how different processing or different curing regimes controlled the creep development in that material. Taking this down to a smaller scale, we were also starting to harness some advanced characterization methods like nanoindentation I'm showing here, in order to better understand how mechanical properties are controlled by microstructure. And in particular, in this example, we're looking at how we could potentially improve strength, durability, and stiffness by controlling the defects that exist, for example, at a fiber cement paste interface. So by doing a heated curing, we can eliminate this lower modulus or weaker region that exists at the fiber cement paste interface. So in this era of strength, there was obviously an emphasis on strength. With that, though, came changes in the way cements were being produced. And so if you're familiar with Dick Burrows, you know this is something that he talks about quite frequently in very long emails to the cements research community. But one of his areas of interest that he points out is that in this era, when we're focusing on strength, we started to see increasing C3S contents, decreasing C2S contents, and increasing fineness in cement to get us these higher early strengths. And as a result, this had a negative impact on other performance criteria. We were increasing strength, but as this plot shows, we were increasing the potential for cracking. And this is some work that Professor Shaw's group really followed up on, showing how if you have even a very small crack, maybe a crack the width of a hair or twice the width of a hair, that that's a large enough crack that you can really compromise the durability of concrete. So we were seeing the cements that were changing to achieve this early strength, but we were losing perhaps durability and crack resistance. And so from there, I'll propose that we then entered this era of performance, where we started saying strength is not the only performance criteria we're interested in. We need to have a renewed emphasis in durability. We also started to see interest in new admixtures to control shrinkage, like shrinkage-reducing admixtures, but also things like viscosity-modifying admixtures that allowed us to create more flowable concrete where we didn't need to compact it. And then also new additives to enhance performance, things like superabsorbent polymers to provide internal curing, and also nanoparticles. So I'll say here we entered an era of high-performance concrete. And so, of course, then there needed to be innovations in the way that we characterize materials. And here I'll just use as one example all the different types of tests that were introduced in order to characterize shrinkage. So we had drying shrinkage, a ring shrinkage test, chemical shrinkage, and then two methods for autogenous shrinkage, among many, many others. So as you can see, with each innovation in cement and concrete technology, we also had to have innovations in characterization. Looking more at more typical types of characterization, maybe, is imaging. And here we can also see that there was progress in the way that we were able to image materials aimed at really enhancing their performance and enhancing their durability. I'm just showing a couple examples of things coming out of our group, including higher resolution SEM that really allows us to probe the very fine structure of cement-based materials. Things like quantitative image analysis, where we can start to quantify the distribution of inclusions or aggregates, quantifying the influence of this interfacial transition zone. Here you can see we've got an aggregate embedded in a cement paste. We applied a compressive stress here, and we were able to map then that the strains are actually concentrated in that interfacial transition zone. And that allows us then to tailor the material. A couple other examples are shown here, things like laser scanning, confocal microscopy. We can use that to quantify fracture surface roughness and compare that to fracture parameters. MRI imaging allows us to track moisture distribution in a cement-based material. And X-ray CT allows us to get past that issue of opacity. We're able to use X-rays to penetrate the material and get an idea of the internal structure. So then getting back to the focus of the presentation, I'll say that we transitioned then from this era focused largely on strength to an era focused on performance. And now perhaps we've entered this era of sustainability. And given the large volumes of concrete that are produced every year worldwide, there's a huge opportunity to make important contributions through innovative green technologies. And to give you an idea here about the potential for impact, you can recall that we had somewhere about 2 cubic yards of concrete placed each year per person and 3 billion tons of cement. But if you look at this plot by a recent paper by Barcelo, what you can see, and I'm having trouble with my laser pointer, I don't know if you all can see it here, in the lower corner over here, we can see a plot showing where concrete and cement lie in terms of embodied CO2 emissions and embodied energy emissions per kilogram. And what you see is that these actually reside fairly low in this plot compared to some other materials. So they're actually fairly sustainable materials. Concrete, because it contains not as much cement, is going to be more sustainable on these two metrics than cement. But compared to other materials, they don't look so bad. It's really simply by virtue of the amounts used every year that we think about concrete contributing maybe 5 to 7% of global CO2 emissions. 5 to 7% of energy consumption each year is associated with concrete production. And it's really because of these numbers here, the huge volume. Now, I'm not going to say I think we should use less concrete. I think concrete is an excellent infrastructure construction material. But I will argue that there are some innovations that can allow us to make concrete even more sustainable while still continuing to produce very durable infrastructure from concrete. And I think we can make a good case for the need for continued construction with concrete. If we look at the world population, we can really see clearly that the trends for increasing world population really scale quite well with the trends in cement production. So clearly, concrete is meeting the infrastructure needs of our growing population. So this will continue to be the material used for infrastructure development well into the future. So before I talk about the innovations and materials characterization and applications that will happen with sustainability, I think it's at least worth it to consider, is this truly a new era? I'm sure there are many out in the audience who've already said, but wait, we've been thinking about concrete in this context for some time now. And I'll say, you know, I chose this sort of beginning of the era here in the mid-2000s based upon when we started to see the word concrete and sustainability being used together in published papers, in peer-reviewed journals. And we can really see that that started to pick up around 2004, 2005, and it's just been increasing since then. So it's not truly a new era. One could maybe assert that we've embraced this philosophy in our research community for some time, even prior, perhaps, to the real broad coining of the term sustainability in the Brundtland Report in 1987. But we really just start to see these publications putting those two words together in the mid-2000s. So I will assert that we could call this an era of sustainability. But of course, it ties to the prior eras that I've already discussed. There's, of course, a linkage to our history. And so here we can see that this concept of sustainability and strength being linked has been something we can understand pretty easily by looking at this plot. This is a life cycle or results from a life cycle analysis that the Portland Cement Association did. And here they look at concrete, which is primarily aggregate, and then contains a relatively small fraction of cement, maybe 12% cement. And what we can see is that even though cement is a relatively small fraction, if we look at the embodied energy, just one metric for sustainability, we can see it embodies 94% of the energy in concrete. with the aggregates being much, much less, around 6%. And so just a simple plot here shows that as we lower the cement content, either by making leaner concrete with less cement or including supplementary cementing materials, things like fly ash or slag that are byproducts, we end up with a concrete that's greener or has a lower embodied energy. Here we can also see the tie to higher strength concrete. This is a nice chart that was published by Andrea Schocker. And here she compares the relative sustainability of 4,000 PSI, or normal strength concrete, to a high strength concrete. Again, tying with our past era based on strength. And here we can see the 9,000 PSI concrete has a much higher cementitious materials content. It also has some silica fume versus the fly ash and the lower strength concrete. But what we can see, is that because of the higher strength, we're actually able to decrease the column cross section, which means that we end up using much less concrete. So going back to that idea to the volumes of concrete that we're using every year, we can actually achieve that through increases in strength and seeing a net reduction in Portland cement of almost 20%. We also are going to be linked to our prior era in performance because sustainability really does rely upon durability, especially in the modern era where we're constructing in more and more aggressive environments, and also with these predictions of increased interactions between the built environment and water. Here I'm showing a map showing projected changes in flood hazard areas in the country in by 2100. If you read this report by AECOM, you see that they predict sea levels to rise by 4 feet. And so we do expect that concrete durability will continue to be a performance issue far into the future, and this is something the community has been addressing by making concrete that's more impermeable and more crack resistant. So this era of sustainability does very much tie to our prior eras in strength and performance. And so we can ask the question again, is this truly a new era? Perhaps not. But I think that there's enough new innovation here and enough new interest here that we can call it a distinct era. I'll go back here to a three-legged stool I drew as a graduate student from my academic grandfather, P.K. Mehta. I apologize for the art. It doesn't look like that stool should be standing, does it? But it has three legs, and I think you can't really give a sustainability presentation without a three-legged stool or a triangle, right? There's always three components. And if we look back here in 1995, P.K. Mehta started talking about this idea that there were three tenets that would support sustainable development in the concrete industry. The first was conservation of concrete-making materials. The second was enhancements of durability. And then the third was this holistic approach to concrete technology research and practice. And so I would say 20 years later, those three tenets are still quite valid. But we do need continued innovation. And so the question I'll ask and try and answer with this presentation is, how will concrete construction continue to evolve to meet this challenge? And I think we've already talked about the first two, increased strength and increased durability. But there's also going to be changes in Portland cement composition that have already happened that will be implemented in a more global scale, alternative binder chemistries that are coming into practice, new functionality, and many, many other approaches. I'm not going to be able to talk about them all. Again, I'm just trying to give a bit of an overview today for people who may not have seen some of these things before. All right, so let's talk about what are some of those green innovations. And one that I think is quite interesting is this potential shift that we're seeing in material specification from prescriptive type specifications found in ASTM C150, where we would type a cement as type 1 through 5 based upon its chemical composition and its fineness largely, to performance-based specifications. 1157 was the performance-based specification that was introduced in 2000. And I say it's a potential shift because the 1157 specification has not gained a lot of traction in terms of practice. But we'll revisit this a bit later in the presentation. But the 1157 specification types of cement based upon the way it performs, its strength developed at different ages, its heat of hydration, expansion during sulfate testing, and as a result, we can have general use cements. And maybe you've bought a bag of cement recently and you've seen it's labeled type 1 or type 1-2/GU. And so that's showing a combination of that cement meets both the prescriptive and the performance specifications. And the nice thing about this specification is it's for all hydraulic cements. So it allows for blended cements, you know, cements that contain supplementary cementitious materials, filler materials as well, and also alternative binder chemistries. And so if we think back to that plot that showed the difference between cement and concrete in terms of the sustainability metrics of embodied greenhouse gas and embodied energy, if we can reduce the amount of cement clinker in concrete, we can have a positive impact on sustainability. So I'll argue that this is one potential avenue for that, but again, one that hasn't quite caught a lot of traction in practice, at least not in the US. What we are seeing quite a bit of traction in, though, and I think if you've been to the talks at this conference, especially yesterday, is there's an incredible interest in these use of limestone or calcium carbonate powders blended with clinker to reduce the clinker fraction in cement. And so worldwide, we see varying amounts of limestone cements being used, somewhere between 5 and 35%. And in the U.S., C-150 and ASHTO M85 were changed just a few years ago to allow up to 5%. So the type 1 cement that you're buying today is actually different than the type 1 cement was that you were buying in the year 2000. So things are changing. And then in 2012, we saw a change in the 595 specification and the ASHTO M240 that allowed a new type of cement, a type 1L, which can contain up to 15% limestone substituted for cement clinker by mass. Typically, these cements are a bit finer than traditional cements, and that can have some implications in terms of setting time and shrinkage, potentially also some changes in creep as well. These are all things that the cements community is currently researching. We're also continuing to see reduced clinker content in concrete through other means, so not just using limestone blended cements. We're also continuing to use these 1S, 1P, and also a new class of 1T, or ternary blended cements, and also higher SCM substitution rates, so up to 90-95% substitutions of cement with things like slag. We're also starting to look at other industrial ways. Here I'm showing a micrograph of a co-fired fly ash, which is a byproduct of green energy production. So instead of burning coal on its own and creating fly ash as a residual byproduct, we're now creating a new class of materials by co-firing coal and biomass. And so this is what we would call a co-fired ash. It doesn't meet the current ASTM C618 specifications because it's not derived purely from coal. It's, again, a co-fired ash, but our research has shown it really does behave essentially just like a true fly ash does, and it's an option for using a new class of industrial waste to supplement sort of decreasing availability of fly ash that we're seeing in the marketplace. There's some regional depletions in fly ash supplies that we're seeing just because of changes in energy trends. I mentioned this change in coal co-firing, but there's also a decreased reliance on coal in the U.S. and an increased reliance on natural gas. Natural gas is a cleaner fuel, but it means less fly ash for us to use in the concrete industry. We're also starting to see increased use of other specialty minerals, things like calcium carbonate, which I've already mentioned, but also clays and heat-treated clays like kaolin and other reactive and non-reactive filler materials. Here I'm showing some work that came out of Karen Scrivener's group at EPFL, where they're blending these new 1L cements, these higher limestone cements, with metakaolin to achieve a 45% clinker reduction and actually achieving higher strength than traditional cements. So it's quite impressive, and I think we'll begin to see more and more trends like this. We're reducing the clinker content in cement. There's also entirely new chemistries that are coming out, and because of the time restrictions here, I'm only going to talk about two. I know that there are many, many other ones out there, but I thought I would pick two that seem to be most relevant. And so one is these calcium sulfo-aluminate cements that can be produced at lower temperatures and also with less calcium carbonate as a starting material. So their embodied CO2 is significantly lower than traditional cement chemistries. And these rely on widely available raw materials. They can also use byproduct materials in the manufacture of these cements. So these could be produced all over the world. These are, you know, cementitious systems that we've known for a long time. This is actually an image that I took for my PhD work. So these are not entirely new chemistries, but we're viewing them through the lens of sustainability. And these do seem to hold a lot of practical promise. This project Aether seems to suggest that there's a major global cement producer. I'll let you read the slide to see who it is, who will be producing a CSA B-Lite cement commercially. Another alternative binder chemistry is a geopolymer. This is a term that's gotten a lot of interest in recent years. Geopolymers are quite similar to what we used to call alkali-activated slags or alkali-activated fly ashes. And so this is a chemistry where we take an aluminosilicate, react it with a strongly alkaline solution, and that could be an alkali hydroxide or an alkali silicate, and we form these amorphous to poorly crystalline aluminosilicate structures that kick out, actually, at the end, the water. So the water is sort of it's a carrier for the alkali in order to initiate the reaction, but it's not necessarily part of the hydrates that are formed at the end. So it's a quite different chemistry than what we see with Portland cements. These are commercially being produced in Australia. They've been used in Russia for decades. We do think, given the body of research in this area, that we will start to see more commercial production of them in North America as well. And there's also new functionalities that can contribute to sustainability. Here's one example, just looking at a photocatalytic cement. These cements have a lot of special properties. One of them is NOx binding, which is, I think, particularly relevant for improving indoor air quality and contributing to sustainability in that way. Also self-healing concrete where we can heal a crack and improve its durability is something that's, I think, also on the forefront of our minds as we do research in material science of cement-based materials. I've neglected up to this point the role of aggregates. Recall the aggregates are about 75 to 80% of the volume, but they embody much less energy than the cements. But I do still believe that there's a tremendous role for aggregates to play. One of them is using recycled concrete or recycled tires or slag or other materials as aggregating concrete where it makes sense. When does it make sense? I think the research is generally in agreement that when you transport the materials less than 50 miles, then you can see that the energy involved in transporting the material does not exceed the energy required to produce virgin material. And one project we had recently where we looked at recycling of aggregate where it made sense was in the Caribbean, where we have space-constrained countries that are also resource-constrained, so where there's not a lot of virgin materials, perhaps after a natural disaster where there's a lot of debris. That problem can become part of the solution as we reconstruct with recycled aggregate concrete. And there are other technologies as well. There's been some research out of France that have looked at CO2 sequestration or capture by binding CO2 to the cementitious paste in a recycled aggregate concrete, and also pervious concrete that allows us to better control the flow of water on a site and eliminate things like retention ponds. So, talked about some of the innovations. Next, I want to talk about innovations or inventions and adaptations and characterization and evaluation that will be required to bring us into this new era. And I don't want to pretend like I'm the first one that's thought about these things. I think a couple of great resources are listed here. One is a paper by Maria Younger and some colleagues that was published in CCR in 2011 that considers four different types of green cements. This came out of an NSF-funded cement chemistry summit that was held in 2009 in Canada, organized by Joe Bernacki. In that paper, they say probably the most daunting challenge is exactly how a testing regime may be designed, which is sufficiently inclusive to test and validate a wide range of binder systems, which is also restrictive enough to ensure good performance of materials when they are mixed in place under less than controlled real-world conditions. So I think very clearly states the need for innovations in testing in order to capture the actual practical application and challenges there with this emerging class of sustainable concrete. NIST also held a more recent workshop in 2012, and their report is available online. A summary of that shows that they've identified some priorities for research in this particular area. The first is identifying or developing tools and metrics for quantifying and comparing different types of sustainable concrete, and also looking at modeling. So I'll follow up on those. Obviously, we do need to be able to compare apples to apples, and so I do think there's continued development and training that's needed in terms of truly quantifying the embodied energy, embodied CO2, and other sustainability metrics so you can appreciate these materials in a global context. And I'm just listing a couple of the tools that have commonly been used here. There are also tremendous opportunities in modeling. In particular, we have a need to understand those linkages between chemistry, structure, and properties. So research is needed at each of those different points in order to build up these models so that we can predict things like setting time, strength evolution, durability in a reasonable way for this new class or this emerging class of materials. So it'll require folks looking at hydration kinetics, for example, thermodynamics, which allows us to predict which phases will be developed in these special types of cements, and then validation with some analytical chemistry. I'm also showing here some recent work that we're doing, trying to understand exactly what's happening in the geopolymerization process. How do these aluminosilicate precursors turn into these alkali-activated or alkali-containing aluminosilicate zeolitic-type products and geopolymers? So really trying to understand how these chemistries produced structure and then trying to, in turn, tailor the chemistry and the structure to get the desired performance. Other opportunities include early age characterization, so looking at concrete as it transitions from as it's in the plastic state and then transitions into the hardened state, looking at variability also there. So some topics I've identified here are things like rheology, showing here some work we've recently done in collaboration with Clarissa Ferraris at NIST, looking at the rheology of geopolymers. And what we can see here very clearly is that not all geopolymers are created the same. And if you've worked with geopolymers, you're probably very much aware that a sodium-activated geopolymer is actually quite a bit stickier to work with than a potassium-activated geopolymer. And the question is why. We can measure it here with a rheometer, but I think that more work is needed to understand the chemistry and understand why that's the case. We also need tests for finishability. There's really no good test for finishability. If you have a sticky mixture, it's going to be challenging to work with in the field. Understanding setting behavior, early shrinkage and strength development, and also admixture interactions. As we start to change our cement chemistries, our existing body of admixtures may or may not be appropriate. And so we need to understand how those admixtures interact with our chemistries and perhaps tailor new admixtures in this era of sustainability. There are other opportunities in multi-scale characterization. I think NSF is using this term a lot, translational research, and so I think I could make an argument here that we really need to develop some translational research in the area of green concrete so that we can better understand the implications of these changes in our materials on constructability. A great example here is a project we had on UHPC where we cast UHPC girders. We tested these very long girders, and we noticed an unusual pattern of failure at the top of the girder where we saw a compression or crushing type of failure that we had not predicted. And it turns out that in flowing the UHPC through the girder as we were casting it, we were unintentionally creating anisotropy. The fibers were aligning and creating opportunities for shear failures during crushing where the load was applied. And we were able to quantify that anisotropy through an image analysis. This is some large-scale testing looking at 100% recycled aggregate concrete. This is something that has not been examined very much in research, and we were able to demonstrate that with adequate reinforcement detailing, you could get good seismic performance even with very low quality or marginal recycled aggregate concrete. And then I think concepts like the shrinkage cracking potential indicator that can be universally applied are the types of research that we really do need to focus on. This is a a measure that compares free shrinkage to tensile strain capacity. So trying to identify metrics that could allow us to predict when any cement chemistry or any concrete chemistry would crack by comparing its shrinkage to its development of its mechanical properties. So the tensile strength development rate is going to be quite different in a geopolymer versus a CSA cement versus a 1L cement. And so an index that can take that into account will be quite valuable. There's also opportunities in long-term performance. We really need to spend a lot of time assessing long-term performance, trying to understand the influence of chemistry and structure, and then developing appropriate destructive and non-destructive tests in order to evaluate long-term performance and damage accumulation. And then those need to be validated through appropriate long-term testing and some type of accelerated laboratory testing. This is a concrete surface resistivity test, which is a test that was, it's been talked about in the literature for a while, but it's really made the leap into practice quite suddenly. I think the Florida DOT has been using it for some time. I know I recall using a primitive version of this when in my graduate studies. But now we're seeing many, many states adopting this. It's a very fast method for assessing the interconnectivity maybe of the porosity or how conductive the concrete is. And what we've been able to do recently is make measurements over time with different types of cements. These are limestone blended cements. And we've been able to see how the resistivity changes over time. And we've been then trying to link that to changes in the structure. So as the resistivity changes, it suggests that we have a more dense, less porous structure. So we need novel test methods that link structure and properties, but we also need to validate through controlled exposure sites or long-term exposure sites, such as the one at Treat Island, Maine. So if we look back or think back on this sustainability stool, we'll recall that there were three different concepts supporting the idea of sustainable development in the concrete industry. We've talked about the first one, I think, quite a bit, that the conservation of materials is very important. We can achieve that in multiple different ways. A few that we talked about already were increased strengths, changes in the Portland cement composition, different binder chemistries, reduction in the clinker content in concrete, and also reuse of waste materials. We've also touched a little bit on the importance of durability. If we can make our structures last longer, we do conserve materials, but we can also enhance durability through new functionality, such as the self-healing of cracks to keep aggressive species outside of concrete, decreasing permeability, having appropriate accelerated testing that allows us to do service life modeling. These are all important things that contribute to this second leg of the stool. The third leg of the stool is one that I haven't really talked that much about yet, and it's one that I spent quite a bit of time thinking about in preparation for this talk, and it's maybe the more nebulous leg on this stool, and that's this idea of a holistic approach to research and practice. And so what does that mean? Exactly. Well, I think we could argue that a holistic approach to research and practice means that we need to comprehensively envision how our research being done on materials and on concretes translates into practice. And I think it suggests that we need some guidance for how to assess these emerging materials so that they can successfully and also rapidly transition into practice in order to address this growing need for infrastructure due to the growing population. And so we can look at some recent ASTM documents, perhaps, for some guidance. ASTM recently passed a document 1709, which is guidelines for assessment of alternative SCMs. So over the years, ASTM has had documents addressing fly ash, slag, and silica fume. But if you were not one of those three, there was no process for validating the use of that material. Okay, so there was no ASTM standard to call out. But now there's this new standard that actually gives five different stages for how to assess a material as an alternative or a new type of SCM. It involves characterization, which we've talked quite a bit about today, looking at physical properties, doing some testing, and also concrete performance tests, and then also field trials and long-term performance, some of the same ideas that we've been talking about in this presentation. So this is sort of what I might view as maybe a roadmap for a way that we might address a broader class of sustainable emerging materials. So not just alternative SEMs, but can we apply this to alternative cements as well? 1157 is another place we could look for guidance in how to translate these innovations in sustainable materials into practice. So 1157 is that performance-based specification. Remember the class or the type GU cements, the HE cements, the MS cements. And so if you read the title of the standard, it's for it's the standard performance specification for hydraulic cement. So it's any cement that reacts with water and forms hydrates. And so is it applicable to for alternative surface cement chemistries? I think potentially it is. Is it applicable to geopolymers? I'm not really sure that they really fit into the spirit of this specification. This test include or the specification calls out a lot of different types of testing, things like fineness, setting time, strength, autoclave expansion, mortar expansion, sulfate expansion. There's a lot of different tests in there, but if you go back and you start to read the specifications, those are all geared for Portland cements. And so it's challenging then to, in the absence of using Portland cement, how do you make these materials equivalent so that they can be compared apples to apples? So some limitations would be, equivalence between the different materials. How do you proportion them? How do you process them? How do you cure them so that we're comparing different materials to one another in a considered way? And then how do we look at concrete constructability and concrete durability? I listed those different test methods in the prior slide for a reason. None of those are looking at things like corrosion resistance. We're not looking at passivation of steel. Do we provide an alkaline enough environment for passivation of steel, for example? And so I will argue that we need a comprehensive framework for multi-scale evaluation of sustainable materials, both binders and concretes. And so to summarize, we've learned that concrete is a ubiquitous but complex material. We've reviewed some of the different innovations in cement and concrete technology that will have a tremendous impact on our ability to create sustainable infrastructure. We talked about a number of different pathways that are being explored. We can't talk about them all, but we talked about the role of increased strength and durability, our history in concrete technology, but also changes in Portland cement composition, alternative cement chemistries, new functionality, the role of aggregates, you name it. I think what we've learned is that there's a need for abundant research, both fundamental and applied, in order to make this translation from research to practice as efficient and timely as possible. And so I'll argue that we need a well-defined but comprehensive framework that's multi-scale that allows us to evaluate sustainable materials in order to make, again, this rapid translation in an economical and global way. And I'll close by quoting one of my colleagues at Georgia Tech, John Crittenden. It's not a Georgia Tech problem that deserves a Georgia Tech solution. This is a gigaton problem that deserves a gigaton solution. So it's really something that we need to put a lot of energy and resources toward, I think, in order to resolve. And with that, I want to acknowledge my wonderful students and my wonderful colleagues at Georgia Tech, and also the support of our sponsors, NSF, GDOT, and FHWA. And thank you for your time.
Okay, well, yes, very good summary. So now we are going to have some questions from the panel members. Let me introduce Eric Landis to my left. He is from University of Maine, and Elaine Hartsey from ETH Zurich. So who wants to start? Elaine?
Well, first of all, thank you for a very nice presentation of the potential given by enhanced materials or improved materials in sustainable construction. You made interesting points, and I think it's the truth is that as the materials become more complex, then you have extra challenges, and they are associated either with the technologies that are required to properly test these materials, but also with the simulation methods. Where do you envision the next, immediately next big step happening, in the simulation or in the testing methodology?
I think it's an excellent question, and I'm not sure that there's a, you know, a set answer to that. I think that we need both, ultimately. I think in some of these instances, with some of these materials that have been around longer, like the calcium sulfoaluminate cements, we do have a body of knowledge that exists in terms of how the materials behave that would allow us to begin to start developing some models. But I think there's still some fundamental questions that need to be answered. With geopolymers, on the other hand, I think we're much further from being able to develop a model to predict performance, because we're still trying to get a good handle on the chemistry there, for example. So I think just as there's varied solutions or potential solutions to address this big challenge, I think that there's also a variety of approaches that are needed, and they will come at different times.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Anything else? Any other questions?
No, that's it for me. Thank you.
Okay. Well, yeah, that's certainly a very good question, and sometimes both go hand in hand, because in order to simulate, you need very precise characterization, and so it's difficult sometimes to know. Eric?
Well, so sustainability, of course, encompasses many, many things outside what we've been talking, or what you've been talking about. And beyond technical issues, there's economic issues, how we consider costs. There's public policy issues that affect how we measure sustainability. And I'm wondering if we're going to adopt these new materials. Of course, you know, civil engineering community is a traditionally very conservative one. What has to happen in order for us to, is it within the technical realm, or do we have to go outside the technical realm in order to adopt these new materials?
It's an interesting question. I think there's, a lot of different ways I could answer it. One, I would say, is we have seen movement already. I mean, I think many of us would have been surprised, 5 years ago, if you told us we'd be using cements that had 15% limestone. People may not have believed that. There may be people, here who didn't realize that the standards had been changed to allow that in ASTM. I was going to say something else. I'm trying to think what it was. So you asked.
Can we, as engineers and researchers alone, solve this problem?
Oh, so I was also going to mention some things that have happened in California. I don't know if you've seen the changes that have been happening there, but there have been some legislation that's been passed that's prompting industries to start quantifying their emissions and looking at ways to reduce those emissions. So there's obviously a policy component here and a societal component as well. The issue of equity with sustainability is also always on the forefront. It's always environment, equity, and economy, right? And so I think economy is also something that we need to consider as we start implementing these changes. And I think that was something I was very mindful of as I was putting the talk together, is that when we think about performance specifications, there's so many different tests that can be required. And so I think it's useful to put a lot of time and energy into coming up with a comprehensive yet thoughtful framework for how to evaluate these technologies. And ACI has this committee on sustainability. They've started on a document looking at implementation of green concrete. I pulled this off the web this morning. It's just a list in their current draft form of Chapter 3 of all the different tests that could be done to qualify a material. And it's very, very long. So I think the potential, the economic cost of doing all these types of tests is really going to be quite a challenge. And so I think there needs to be some type of an entity or body that starts to look at identifying which of these tests are necessary. Do we need to do the same tests to qualify a material for a bridge deck that we would do for a precast concrete versus a sidewalk? So starting to think in those types of ways can allow us to make that translation effectively in a timely and economical way.
Okay, so let's open up the discussion, Professor Bazant.
But I think you take mainly the viewpoint of ACI. In mechanics community, we need somewhat broader viewpoint. ACI code still does not recognize fracture mechanics. They still don't accept size effect. Yet it's very important for sustainability. If a design code which ensures for small structures fail probability 1 out of 1,000,000, which is required. It also ensures that very large structures have fail probability about 1 out of 1,000. And this is historically proven. There are statistics in Australia, in Scandinavia, that very large concrete structures have been historically failing with probability 1 out of 1,000. Now, it does not produce public uproar because not so many such structures. But if somebody lives in that bridge, record bridge, which he or she has to cross every day, the probability of 1,000 is unsustainable. We cannot go on this way. We have to look that there are two aspects to this. One is, you mentioned high-strength concretes. They're not only high strength. There's also high fracture energy, which is usually not attained, and even more large material characteristic lengths. Because that's what assures ductility, which postpones the deleterious dangerous effect of fracture mechanics. And the other one is the codes. If ACI continues this way, we are not sustainable. That's my view.
So I think you brought up some very good points, and some of them that reinforce some of the things that I was saying here. One is that we need to go beyond compressive strength. We need to look at toughness. We need to look at crack resistance when we talk about mechanical performance. I think also, you know, I'm showing this ACI 130 committee work. It's a start. It is, it's a work in progress, and it's been much slower, I think, than many of us would like to see. So I also prepared some slides here looking at maybe some other groups that are moving quite a bit faster in terms of translating these green technologies from the lab to the field. And I think a good example of this would be the work that came out of RILEM technical committees that's now been translated by the FHWA, and it's changed the way that we're practicing the design of concrete to avoid alkali silica reaction, for example. So it's an entirely new way of looking at how we design concrete. We're looking at issues like variability and risk assessment, which you also brought up very eloquently. And so we're trying to say, you know, different types of concrete or concrete used in different classes, you might be willing to accept more or less risk, depending on if it's a bridge that's very long or needs to last 200 years versus a sidewalk or a barrier. And so this RILEM FHWA framework addresses both that risk and also the different classes of concrete. So I showed the ACI 130 example as a document that's definitely a work in progress that's addressing sustainability. But I think we also have other models from other communities that are perhaps creating this framework that we need to evaluate materials in a much more rapid way.
We have time for, yes, please.
Professor. As you show on the chart, that if you compare to other materials, concrete actually is not the dirtiest one in terms of embedded energy and the CO2 emission. I wonder if you can say a few words about the potential to further reduce that embedded energy or CO2 emission rather than just using less material. Is there any more way to go in that direction to reduce embedded energy and the CO2 emission?
And so some of the things that I talked about do get at that. The alternative cement chemistries typically can be produced at a lower temperature, which means we reduce the CO2 emissions associated with fuel usage in cement manufacture. We do have to be mindful that the clinkers are still easily ground, so we're not, you know, shooting ourselves in the foot there by having more grinding energy. But also looking at chemistries that have less reliance on calcium carbonate, which have a lower CO2 emissions, because when we're making cement, we're basically taking calcium carbonate and decomposing it into calcium oxide that then combines with other elements to form new phases, and then releasing CO2. So if we can reduce the amount of calcium carbonate in our feedstock material, we can also have greener cements. So there's a couple of different ways to go at it from cement chemistry, but also then just reducing the clinker fraction in concrete by extending cements by using inert filler materials that require no processing or firing beyond just grinding the material. That's one option, and then also increased use of byproduct materials, which is a practice that the concrete community has been using really since its inception, since Roman times. They've been using, you know, pozzolanic materials, and so that practice hopefully will continue. But the example I gave, though, of Karen Scribner's group, I think is a really powerful one, and Gaurav Sant's group at UCLA has also been looking at this, combining these 1L cements, these 15% calcium carbonate cements, with other mineral phases like metakaolin to essentially have the clinker fraction in cement is a way to shift our concrete even lower in that construct where we're comparing greenhouse gases to embodied energy. So yes, I think that's the way to go, is we need to continue to reduce on both of those metrics in a variety of ways.
Yes, Professor Maggi.
Thank you for a very broad presentation, and the innovations in this field are really incredible. My question is, are universities engaged in all of this innovation able to get patents, perhaps licenses, and actually reap any of the rewards, financial rewards, of all of this, or is that going primarily to the corporate sector of the large companies that do this?
Well, I guess I can give one example. We recently did file an invention disclosure on something related to enhancing durability through the use of some nanoparticles. So I would say, yes, there's absolutely room for innovations to happen at the university level in this context.
Yes. And then, yeah, you go ahead. I can see the question. So.
Thank you. You mentioned the accelerated testing, yeah, for new materials. If we want to get the life cycle performance or sustainability. So, but you didn't talk too much about the fundamental. Like, what kind of fundamentals we can develop accelerated testing methods? Do you have any like comments about this direction?
Are you speaking with regard to durability accelerated test methods?
Yes, yeah.
It's always a challenge, isn't it? And I think that's something that was really captured in that quote that I shared from Maria Younger's. You know, to develop an appropriate accelerated test method, you need to have some comparisons, right? We need to compare these new materials to some traditional materials. Once we can do that and we know how our accelerated test perhaps predicts how conventional materials will perform, then if we understand the chemistry and structure of our new materials, that may help us in modeling service life for the new materials. But I agree, it's a big challenge. It's a really big challenge.
Seems that the next session starts 2:30 and we have to move from here to there. So I would like to close this session with thanking Professor Kimberly Kurtis for the talk.